Everyone, welcome to Madden Science. Today's flipped classroom lesson is all about evolution. As always, flipped classroom ideas are going to be like this. Once you're taking notes, taking some drawings, writing down some general questions, also some specific ones to a specific point, follow along with your book if you can. Keep in mind that you can pause the video, go back, screenshot it, redo it. I'm trying to be as comprehensive as I possibly can, but keep in mind, evolution is a gigantic topic, so we're only going to touch on the surface of it. Hopefully give you a fairly comprehensive overview, but still, it'll be going quickly, so hold on, pay attention, go back, rewind when you need to, and in the end, once you add in one comment in the comment section, you can comment on somebody else's comment if you like. You can include a link, website, resource, news. You want it to be interesting, cool, specific. Don't just link to the definition of evolution. Also, make sure that you tag the video time. Here's our plan and our flow. We'll start with context, move through background, get into the specifics of evolution and its tenets, look at some definitions and key terms, give you a number of examples to try and solidify those key terms, get into adaptations, and we'll end with connections and kind of hit those as we go. It's all starting with our two main men, Charles Darwin and Alfred Wallace. Our context for our class right now in this video comes from AP Environmental Science, Unit 2, The Living World, Biodiversity. We're looking specifically at 2.1 biodiversity, 2.3 biogeography on islands, and 2.6 adaptations. But keep in mind, this can apply to a regular biology class or AP biology class too. Here's our vocab for unit 2. A little bit hard to see on here, but you could pull it up on your own. 2.1, 2.3, and adaptations 2.6. You can see this a little bit bigger and more clearly here. Intro to BioD, island biogeography, and adaptations. Just got an email the other day. It said, top five ways evolutionary science is changing modern medicine. From cancer research, antibiotic resistance, autoimmune disease, diabetes and heart disease, offer new perspectives. Evolution is everywhere. And as to our background in history and philosophy of science, it was Dobzhansky who said, nothing in biology makes sense except in light of evolution.
Give a prize for the single best idea anybody ever had, I'd give it to Darwin for the idea of natural selection. Ahead of Newton, ahead of Einstein, because his idea unites the two most disparate features of our universe. The world of purposeless, meaningless matter and motion on the one side, and the world of meaning and purpose and design on the other.
And my favorite living biologist, E.O. Wilson, who says the two rules of biology are that all living things and processes follow the laws of physics and chemistry, and that all living things and processes evolve through natural selection. And in On the Origin of Species, Charles Darwin said, there is grandeur in this view of life. From so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and most wonderful, have been and are being evolved.
What Charles Darwin glimpsed over 150 years ago is now the bedrock of biology. All forms of life on Earth have evolved on a single branching tree of life.
One of the most important ideas that Darwin had was that all living things on Earth were related. How can you realize that you are part of this single tree of life and not be fundamentally moved by that? It's something that stirs the soul.
Here's a really interesting diagram from AP Biology from Campbell. If you zoom in, you can see Darwin as the red and central figure, Wallace coming, you know, about 20 years afterwards, but also living the same time. You can see some of their influences. on the top with the name and the topic, and then some of the important articles and papers below. Linnaeus, Hutton, Lamarck, Lyell, and then certainly afterwards with Mendel. Here's an interesting map that shows Darwin's voyage along the HMS Beagle. Certainly his most formative stop happening in and on here with the Galapagos Islands. Now if we take a peek, here's our Galapagos Islands. It's just about 300 miles or so off the coast of Ecuador. Clearly this relates to island biogeography too. If you zoom out just enough and slide over here, you can see where Wallace did his main work in the South Pacific, in and around Borneo. And right here, we'll talk about the Wallace line coming up soon. If we jump back, we see a really cool quote from Charles Darwin while he was aboard the Beagle. We've got a good picture of Alfred Wallace. Now, the coolest resource that I found on the history philosophy of evolution as it relates to Charles Darwin and Alfred Wallace is with HHMI's Biointeractive, The Making of a Theory. So you can check it out on our website or search for it on YouTube. It's beautiful. Here we get into the tree of life. So it is, or it was, Darwin's goal to observe and make commentary on the origin of species. How is it that new species come about? How is it that we can model and see the tree of life and see a universal ancestry? This website here, onezoom.com, is awesome. So if I zoom out, it's pretty interactive. You see the fractal nature of a tree of life here, broken apart with archaea, bacteria, eukaryotes. We can zoom in. Here's archaea and eukaryotes. If we get into eukaryotes specifically, zooming in on animals and on hexapods or insects, you got a picture of a ladybug in there, and you see that repetitive nature of this beautiful tree of life imagery. So you could spend all day on that. We'll move on for now. Other interesting ways of diagramming the tree of life can be seen here. And these guys are gonna be based primarily on phylogenetics, or the evolutionary relationship between organisms as seen primarily in their genetic makeup. So DNA, RNA, and even at times protein structure and amino acid structure. Here has a really interesting diagram, and on the x-axis, you can see the timeline. This is probably my favorite far side all time. Great moments in evolution. So not just funny, but actually kind of true. So there was at one point a time when fish moved on to land. Maybe it was after they hit their baseball there, maybe not. That ancestor is called Tiktaalik, seen here. Here's the segment of its tree of life as scientists envision it now. You can see Tiktaalik right there in the middle and some of his ancestors. Here in the bottom is somewhat of what he might have looked like in real life at the time. This is similar too to what you might see if you explored hominid or human evolution, here with that branching structure for our particular branch or twig on the tree of life. All right, we're going to look closely at definitions and tenets within evolution. Let's start here. So, two observations, two inferences. Members of a population often vary in their inherited traits. So evolution is going to focus on just what's inherited, the genetics. So if you have your phenotype, your physical characteristics, those are going to be based upon your genotype, so DNA, RNA. Your phenotype is also based on your environment. So that's your nature and nurture component. Also depend on your developmental stage. Again, evolution is only dealing with the genetics or the inherited part of your phenotype or your variation. Observation two, all species can produce more offspring than their environment can support, and many of the offspring fail to survive and reproduce. And because of that, individuals whose inherited traits give them higher probability of surviving and reproducing in a given environment tend to leave more offspring than do other individuals. So key points here, higher probability and given environment. So there's no guarantee that you survive and reproduce more, just higher probability. So the percentage is a little bit higher, and then given environment. So it's not that there's one definition of most fit, but rather it's the organisms that are most adaptable to their given environment. And inference two, this unequal ability of individuals to survive and reproduce will lead to the accumulation of favorable traits in that population over generations. So evolution acts on individuals and their variations that are inherited, but it's populations that evolve, not individuals. So to summarize, you got variation, some of that's heritable, you have overproduction, some of those organisms have a reproductive advantage that leads to a change in the population or a change in allelic frequency. We'll cover those genetic terms in a little bit. And that is natural selection. Here it is summed up in four steps again. So to look at that change in allelic frequency and the role of environmental pressures, we can take a look at HHMIs or biointeractives making of the fittest with rock pocket mice. So take a look here. You have two locations, and really it's a before and after. Location A, starting with mice, and you can see here that you have light-colored mice and dark-colored mice. And in this one, the light-colored mice are far more camouflaged than are the dark mice. And they also are greater in number. So the allelic frequency has light mice or the light gene, light coat gene, being much higher than the dark. You could count them up to do the percentages if you wanted. Either way, this camouflage allows them to get eaten less by hawks and owls and other predators. And so the natural balance at this point was that there were far more light than dark. Now there was an environmental event, environmental pressure, where there's a change due to volcanic eruption and the ground color changed. It became much darker. Now, guess who's got the advantage? It's the dark-coated mice. So they're more camouflaged, less likely to get eaten. And so you get a slow but consistent change in that population, a change in the allelic frequency. The brown ones went up and the light color ones went down. This is similar to what you'd see with peppered moth and industrial melanism. I got my peppered moth shirt on today just for this video. Check it out. So pre-industrial revolution, you can find peppered moths hanging out on their trees, and they're incredibly camouflaged. You may not have even seen that initially. And you had black-colored or melanic moths too. So both existed. At some point, this variation was caused by a mutation. Either way, pre-industrial revolution, these guys camouflaged more easily, so birds and bats and other predators would eat them less often than the dark-colored ones, where they'd blend into the lichen and the bark. Now, during and post-industrial revolution, you had pollution that killed off lichens and soot that colored in the trees. And now, due to a change in the environment, the black-colored or the melanic moths have a much greater advantage, and the peppered moths now are going to stick out like a sore thumb. So in terms of allelic frequency, there's a decrease in peppered moths and an increase in melanic moths. Now, if you look at this graph, you can see as we move in a decrease in smoke pollution in the 60s, 70s, 80s, the number of melanic moths decrease. So you have a shift, again, because of a change in the environment. This is much of what Charles Darwin was talking about in The Origin of Species, specifically as he was traveling around on the Galapagos Island. You can see in the corner, oh wow, Lizard City. But even more foundational to the theory of evolution and Darwin's studies were finches, probably the most famous of evolutionary model organisms. And you see that their environmental pressure as they move from mainland, right, if we kick back over, zoom out, at some point you had ancestral finch that came from the mainland and made it 300 miles or so to the varying islands. And these islands differ in climate and soil and food sources. And that difference in food source shaped through environmental pressure over many years the beak shape of these finches. You can see it here. Leaf eater insects, tools, grubs, generalists with seeds, And this wasn't just over thousands and millions of years. You could see this over the course of years in modern day when scientists look at the effect of drought or changes in food sources. See it here even with different species on different islands within the Galapagos. It's also important to note that Darwin based his theories of natural selection on ideas of artificial selection. Artificial selection has its most common use or understanding within agriculture. So the way in which humans have produced crops to benefit us. So from wild mustard, you can have kale, Brussels sprouts, cabbage, broccoli, kohlrabi. Here's a figure that shows just a different part of the plant that's modified and cultivated to produce those different plants that we now eat. You can see it here with ancient and modern corn, probably most famously with the evolution and origin of our modern domesticated dogs. So in this case, from wolf to wolf, or wolf to all different sorts of dogs. In summary, you can see here, we've got rock pocket mice, started out light, fewer dark to match the ground. There was environmental change, a volcano, ground color changed, and in the end, you actually have a shift in allelic frequency. This is much of what you saw with peppered moths, higher degree of peppered versus black, and then a change. And it's not unlike what you see with the adaptive radiation or divergent evolution present in Galapagos finches. This would be a good place to pause to look at these different examples of principles and examples of natural selection. Closing out this part with environmental pressures and some key points. First, populations evolve, not individuals. Evolution can be measured. We'll look at Hardy-Weinberg later, possibly in another video. Evolution deals only with what is heritable, and favorable traits depend, right? It's context specific, depends on environmental pressures. A study you can look at here with guppies and pools, or even here to Florida with invasive species here with soapberry bugs and their beak length here in orange versus green. So orange beak length with their native species balloon vine, and green and introduced golden rain tree, where the beak length had to get longer in order to adapt for a deeper fruit within that seed. Definition wise, let's check it out. We'll start with homology. Homo for same. This is referring to similarity resulting from common ancestry. Most common examples are going to be with anatomical homologous structures. Here you have, say, the forelimb of a mammal, in case human, cat, whale, or bat, and you have the same structure, so one bone, two bones, many bones, few bones, so humerus, radius, and ulna, in us used for grasping or throwing or riding, in a cat for running, whale for swimming, bat for flying, so common ancestry that experienced different environmental pressures that shaped them as they adaptively radiated out. Another example, again, terminology-wise, homology or divergent evolution or adaptive radiation here in the Hawaiian Islands with plants, very similar to what you saw on the Galapagos Islands with finches. And this is indeed what Charles Darwin was drawing with his original tree of life. Conversely to that, if you look at analogous structures, you have the opposite. So distant ancestry, common environmental pressure. So you have different structures performing similar or the same function. So kind of the flip-flop of what you saw with homologous structures. Here you got three fish and one mammal, or even here, one bony fish and two cartilaginous fish or sharks. And they look pretty similar. So distant ancestry between these guys, right? And yet they look the same in the same or similar fusiform shape. Can see it across the world with studies in biogeography, first made famous with Alfred Wallace. So North America versus Australia, flying squirrels and sugar gliders, they look the same. You'd think they'd be very close related, but they're pretty distant. It's just that they occupy very similar niches and have similar environmental pressures that have shaped them in very similar ways. Here you can see it with toucans and hornbills, dugongs and manatees, llamas and giraffes, mara and English rabbits. This is a quick slide on what we've referred to earlier in the Wallace line in South Pacific. Now, homology can be molecular too, so not just anatomical as we saw, but a way of comparing similar DNA, similar RNA, or in this case, similar amino acid structure and peptide or protein structure. It should make sense. The more similar that structure is or amino acid sequence is, the more closely related as you look at humans versus monkeys, mice, chicken, frog, and lamprey. Quickly, onto island biogeography. The source is the theory of island biogeography. E.O. Wilson again and MacArthur. Really interesting, Planet Earth 2 on islands. But the source to go to is HHMI Biointeractive on island biogeography. It's called From Ants to Grizzlies, starring E.O. Wilson. It's beautifully done. And this highlights some key findings like we saw in our island biogeography lab. And that is, if you look on the left side, if you're looking at rate of probability of colonization, you see the closer you are to the mainland, the higher the rate of colonization or emigration, and the farther away you are, the lower. Now, if you look on the right side for rate or probability of extinction, this is related to size of the island. So the smaller the island is, the higher the rate of extinction. The larger island, the lower the rate. All right, on to some examples and evidence, coevolution. Beautiful examples of coevolution would be with pollinators, with hummingbird and flower, or with orchids that have a specific plant species to animal species. We got other birds that do it, bees, wasps that can pollinate the human microbiome. We got evolutionary arms races. Classic example with cheetahs and gazelle. The faster the cheetah, the faster the gazelle. The faster the gazelle, the faster the cheetah. It is the slow cheetahs or the slow or not high endurance gazelles that unfortunately don't make it, but that strengthens their population over time as they battle back and forth. Here's an interesting quote from Richard Dawkins.
Stand tall, bipedal ape. The shark may outswim you, the cheetah outrun you, the swift outfly you, the capuchin outclimb you, the elephant outpower you, the redwood outlast you. But you have the biggest gift of all, the gift of understanding the ruthlessly cruel process that gave us all existence, the gift of revulsion against its implications, the gift of foresight, something utterly foreign to the blundering, short-term ways of natural selection, and the gift of internalizing the very cosmos.
Now, probably the most classic example of the evolutionary arms race is going to date back to the dawn of penicillin, when many scientists believed they had won the war against microbes, against bacteria. Turns out we haven't. And so we're continuing a battle against superbugs and HIV that's resistant to drugs and bacteria that are resistant to antibiotics. We see it in the battle with animal to animal. So rattlesnake to ground squirrel, as the venom gets more toxic and the ground squirrels become more resistant, and they go back and forth, up and up. And really it's all about relationships. You can see it with symbiosis and mutualism, commensalism and parasitism. Here's a chart that shows those along with some subsets. Maybe my favorite example would be with coral. As they start to get overgrown with seaweeds, they'll send out chemical signals that attract mutualistic helpful fish to come and eat those seaweed. A beautiful example is from Planet Earth 2 in grasslands with bee eaters and elephants, also with ostriches at times. And we had lots of examples of parasites. Probably my favorite is with cordyceps and ants. So a fungi that takes over the minds of different insects. And that too breeds and leads to a more fit and adapted and strong ant or whatever insect population. This brings us to adaptations, a change or the process of change by which an organism or species becomes better suited to its environment, where there's an increase in fitness. Now, that better suited to its environment obviously is context dependent and depends on environmental pressures. So if we think back to adaptations that we've already talked about, we can go way back to the tree of life, human hominid evolution. We saw it with Tiktaalik. We saw it in a number of examples up further, starting with pollinators and gut microbiome, adaptations of the cheetah to be faster, more agile, more balanced, more cunning, endurance, balance, strength within gazelles. You see it clearly with, say, bacteria and antibiotic resistance, as they have antibiotic pumps that pull them in and spit them out, or pull them in and chop them up, or pull them in and digest them, use them for energy. See it in all sorts of adaptations within symbioses or coevolution behaviors. We saw it in class, offense, defense, right? Predator, prey relationships and adaptations. Seen here with coloration that's camo or cryptic, warning or aposematic, different kinds of mimicking. Here's a eyelash viper that was super camo, took this picture in Costa Rica, thing nearly struck me in the shoulder. I was once kayaking underneath a tree and looked up a bunch of bats. So not only really good camouflage, but their probably greatest adaptation is echolocation, being able to, in a sense, see with sound. Walking sticks. Here's the aposematic, or from the Greek away sign. Another adaptation is the poison itself in these poison dart frogs. Here, Dendrobates aratus, took this in Costa Rica. Or a funny joke from The Onion. You have other examples, the art of deception from National Geographic, or even where an animal would mimic not just the shape or look or coloration, but also the movement and the walking pattern of other organisms. In this case, a lizard mimicking a beetle. All right, closing out, redoing some of our connections. Probably our best source will be books on the Origin of Species by Charles Darwin. We had some books mentioned with Island Biogeography, E.O. Wilson, or any of his books. An awesome one is on leaf cutters, to name a number of other ones. Richard Dawkins and The Selfish Gene is great. We've got video resources. The best, most comprehensive example, I think, is PBS Evolution. There's many of other PBS ones, including NOVA's, HHMI Biointeractive. Check them out. Berkeley Evolution, also books. Campbell AP Bio is probably the best. All right, thanks a lot for listening along, following with us on this evolution journey. Remember to please post your comments below, make them time-stamped and specific. Also, I'd love to have some feedback. How can we improve these lessons, make them better for you next time? So until then, take care, everybody.